stop showing closest and pull the illegal line belt to disable the motor. If on the other hand, the walking motor is running full speed, we'll stop pulsing at tempo down line 5, and this will cause the motor to be enabled constantly and spin at full speed. In order to show you how the L-290 looks, a sample of experiments on my workbench. When I've done this, using my L-290, I remove the five-volt jump restraint powers with the external supply. I've given the power supply to it, but I've done it with the little bumper burner. That's the reduce my five-volt power supply down to 7.4 volts. Now you might be wondering why 7.4 volts would be looking at that. Is that two transistors that the switches and the L-298 are each going to have a voltage drop of 0.7 volt? So all I need to do is apply 1.4 volts more than my voltage actually requires. So if you have 6-volt motors, I've given it 7.4 volts. Well, this is the 7.4 volts. I didn't have the 5-volt power supply, I'm just using my desk supply for that for now. I've attached two motors to the motor A and motor B, and I've also run the 5 volts over to my solder's breadboard. At this point, I've then taken all the inputs to the LC98 and wired them up to the breadboard so that I can experiment with the inputs to send them to either ground or 5 volts. Okay, for the first experiment, this is how I've wired the inputs. I've set enable 1 to 5 volts, which is a high. Input number 1 is also 5 volts, and input number 2 is a ground. These are the lines of control motor number A. For motor B, I've taken input number 3 and set it to 5 volts. Input number 4 has been grounded, and enable number 2 has also been grounded. So when I do this, what will happen is that motor A will be closed. Motor B, however, won't move at all, and as because the enable line is set to ground, and you can see that as follows. Okay, for the second experiment, I must take an even team to control motor B, and I'm going to need it high as well. In this case, both of our motors will move forward. Next, I'm going to reverse the inputs for motor number A. So I'm going to take input number 1 and ground it, and input number 2, and ground it to 5 volts. This will cause motor A to run in reverse, while motor B still runs in the forward direction. And last but not least, I've taken both of them. Input 1 is grounded, so enable number 1 is grounded, and so is enable number 2. In this configuration, both motors will simply be off. And as you can see, they are. So now that we've shown how the L298 works with the breadboard, the time left for the output equation and see how we can get to control the speed of the motor just well with the ground. I've taken a 5-volt power supply, and I've used the 5 volts of ground to the earthmotor panel to power the L298 logic circuits. I've got the inputs from the L298 to a series of digital outputs from the earthmotor and hook up to this box. I've taken the enable 1 line in the L298 and connected it to the digital output pin 9 in the earthmotor. Input 1 on the L298 is connected to the digital output pin 8. Input 2 is connected to output pin 7. Input 3 to output pin 5. Input 4 to output pin 4. And the enable 2 line on the L298 is connected to the earthmotor digital output pin 3. Again, you can use different output pins on the earthmotor with your local modified sketch, but just keep in mind with both of the enable lines. Make it a signal between the digital output pin that is typical of cultural modulation. Let's look at our original sketch into our motor demo. Now we're going to start off by declaring a number of integers for motor A and for motor B. I need to get the inputs of the L298 and the ENA and ENB are the enable lines for motor A and motor B. And then IN1, IN2, IN3, and IN4 are simply inputs 1, 2, 3, and 4 to the board. Now again, you can use different pin numbers if you wish, but it's defining different numbers for the integers. However, keep in mind that enable A and enable B have these pins that are capable of pulsing modulation. Pins 9 and pins 3 are capable of PWM, so if you're changing this, keep that in mind. After we define the integer, we're going to just go to the check routine and check all of them on set outputs because all of these are outputs in the output result because we're being used in the L298 tens. Similar to set before, two functions. The first function is called demo 1. And demo 1 will run the motor to both direct statistics. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to turn on both number 8 and put 1 and put 2 ones. So we're going to set the speed of motor is we're going to be using analog light command. That analog light will run pulse with modulation signals out to PWM enabled pin from the output result. And if you have a range of 0, it's basically 255, which is full speed. We're going to check into analog light 200, so it's going to be near full speed but not quite. And then we're going to do the same thing for motor B. We're going to set it on in one direction. And we're going to set it on to an analog right of 200. Now we're going to run the motor to that speed for 2 seconds, so we put the way for 2,000 milliseconds here. And then we're going to change the motor track. So we're going to take inputs 1, 2, 3, and 4, and set them to the first two motors over down here. And then the motor will just continue to run after 200, with the analog right still 200, we do that for 2 seconds. And then we're going to turn the motors on by setting inputs 1, 2, 3, and 4, all to a value of 1. That's basically our first demo. Now we have a function for demo number 2. What this is going to do is going to run the motor to pass all the way to possible speed. It's going to run it up to full speed, and then run it down to low speed. So first of all, we're going to go and set the motors on again in the forward direction, so we set inputs 1, 2, 3, 4 accordingly. And then we're going to take a loop and accelerate it to 0 to maximum speed. Now in this loop, we're going to take the integer called pi, and we're going to loop it between the value of 0 and 255. And so we're going to do analog rate to table A and A to B. We're going to start off with 2,000, then we're going to delay it for 20 milliseconds as we get connected, and the values will be found. We'll delay it for 20 milliseconds, et cetera, all the way until the distance of 255. Once we do that, we're going to do the positive thing. We're going to run a loop for several minutes after connected. So this is the same thing except we're starting at the value of 255, but we're here waiting on to the value of 0 and the decrement. And so again, we're going to start off with an analog write with 255 feet to the motors, delayed by 20 milliseconds, and then go to 254, delayed by 20 milliseconds, etc., until we get down to 0. And then finally, we're going to write digital writes to allow the control of the turn off the motors. So now that we've defined those two functions, in the loop, all we simply do is we run demo 1, and then we delay it for a second, and then we run demo 2, delay it for another second, and then we repeat the self-infinitely. So this is basically our motor demo for taking a look. All right, let's look at the motor demo. sketch onto my Arduino, and temporarily unplug the USB cable from the Arduino because the sketch will start immediately as soon as the Arduino is powered up. Otherwise, everything's connected up above the power supply connected to the O298N board. The motors are connected to it as well, and the board is connected to the Arduino. So, as soon as it's powered, it should start a demo sketch. Let's take a look at that. And it runs through. You see it'll repeat. It starts by going forward, goes backwards, and then it gradually comes up to speed. Now let's expand the monitor to connect a couple of potentiometers with variable resistors up to the Arduino board. This will allow us to manually control the speed of each motor. Now the value of these potentiometers is not particularly important. As long as they are transient or higher, these are worse. We also want to get linear feedback potentiometers, and these are the most common types anyway. Now one end of each product is connected to the ground, and the other end of it is connected to 5 volts. The multiple components of solder is breakboard to simplify the connections, although that is illustrated here. So one third of each product is connected to one of the analog inputs on the Arduino. Now it's connected to part A to analog input 0, and part B to analog input 1. As you know, the whisper is an analog input 7 to 5, with the same part of that circle. The sign from the 2 can be on the Arduino, and take a look at the step that we're going to be using. Now let's get first on the same way as the last sketch. We find a number of integers, and the output pins of the Arduino that we're using with inputs, the LC9 and N. We've done a number of integers over here. Speed control 1, speed control 2, and these are the same 0 and 1, these are the analog inputs to the Arduino. Now if you want to change to the other analog inputs, then you change the value of the 0 and 1 to the S. Now there are a couple of integers that decide to move the motor speed 1 or speed 2, which represents the speed between the motors, holding the value of the value of 0. And we've done for the setup, which is identical to the last program, except all of the built outputs to the hardware test outputs. We don't need to set the analog inputs on this input because by nature they're already inputs. Then everything is happening in the loop. We'll set the motors to forward direction by letting the IM1, IM2, IM3, and IM4 pins. And then we're going to read the values from the potentiometers using the analog read pin command. Now the analog read function uses the internal analog to digital converter is built into the Arduino. This is a pinned analog to digital converter, so we're going to get values from 0 to 1023. Now, if you recall, we do an analog write to send pulses modulation out to our enable lines. We can take a value from 0 to 255. So we find the range of 0 to 10.3. To enable 0 to 255, there's a couple of ways we've done this. One way is to use into the 5 of values by 4, and that will actually work this con. So I'll show you here our Google math function. If you haven't used the math function before, it's a good function to get familiar with. What math does is it takes one range of our take 0 to 10.3 and maps it out to another range of 0 to 255. This really works well when you have two ranges of the junctions that we divide into each other. And so I set motor speed to map to a value of 0 to 255. And then the last thing I do here is I have found that the motor has to start at the front, and that's a very, very low value. And so what I've done is I simply include these if statements. And if the statements are say that the motor speed is anything less than 8, then we'll just call it a 0 because the motor must be found out together with the motor part of the check. Anyone who adjusts this value of 8 to 0 for particular motors. And then finally, we do an analog write of motor speeds from enable A and enable B, and that sends the pulse width modulation out to our motors. And this is removed from the continuous frequency, re-represent the other values, and send the values out to the two enable ones. And that's the first step, so let's watch it there. Okay, now that we've hooked up the two pots to load our sketch, let's try it out. We'll turn the pot for motor number A. And again, it goes to speed. Motor B. Check that. So now we see how we can use two potentiometers to control two motors with an Arduino. Let's take it a step further. Our two motors you've noticed have been mounted onto a robot car base. Well, I'd like to do that and drive this little car around the road. Now two potentiometers are going to be a very difficult method of controlling a car, plus I have no method of actually reversing it. So I decided to do this with two pots of the joystick. Now the joystick essentially consists of two potentiometers, one that controls the vertical or y-axis, and the other one that controls the horizontal or x-axis. A joystick also contains a momentary contact switch, but we're not going to use that in this particular hookup. Now let's take a look at how I put the joystick up. Essentially what it does is place the potentiometers with it. The joystick also has two pins, one labeled PCC and one labeled ground. I've connected PCC to my 5-volt power supply from the Arduino, and I've connected the ground, of course, to the ground line. Now the vertical output I've connected to analog input A0, and the horizontal output is to analog input A1, again just the same way I had the potentiometers. Now what I've done is I've arranged the joystick so that when I push the joystick forward, the motors will drive the car forward. When I pull it backwards, the motors, of course, will drive it backwards. When I move the joystick a bit to the left, the car will steer to the left. When I move it to the right, it will steer to the right. As you can see over here, when I push the joystick forward, it's going over. When I pull it backwards, it will go the other direction. If I move it out to the left, one motor steers faster than the other. And when I move it to the right, the opposite of the other. So now we've looked at that. Let's take a look at the sketch. It takes all this possible. And then we'll take a stick with the car and drive it around the room. So here's the sketch. I've come up with a way to control my little car with a joystick. Now, as with all the other sketches, you can find these on drone.workshop.com, along with a complete explanation of each sketch. I'm going to go over this one with you right now. Now, we start off the same as we have with our other sketches. We find a number of integers, and these are the inputs to the enable lines from the L298 to N. Then we've got the analog inputs to the Arduino, which I've mapped out to join those into a course in the vertical and horizontal potentiometer and joystick. As with our last sketch, we define a couple of integers to represent the motor speed. The motor only with 1 and 0. We've also got a couple of new values here for the vertical and horizontal positions of the joystick, and they're initialized at 5 as well. Now, remember that the analog to digital converter in the Arduino will convert to input pulses to values between 0 and 10.3, so 5 current is pretty low in the middle of the range. Then the setup component is either pins and outputs as we did before, and we'll also start our motors off, both disabled with enable A in row and enable B in row, and also set with the motor to spin in forward direction.
Oh!